all of us come from operating backgrounds, and I would say that DNA kind of flows in somewhat automatically. You want to roll up your sleeves. You're going to help the companies to the extent they need, right? We're not enforcing this. And I would say that combined with, I would say, yeah, to some extent, a Midwest pragmatism in building these businesses, I do think that differentiates.
The startup investment landscape is changing, and world-class companies are being built outside of Silicon Valley. We find them, talk with them, and discuss the upside of investing in them.
Welcome to Upside.
Hello, 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 and welcome back to the Upside Podcast, the first podcast finding upside outside of Silicon Valley. I'm Jake Laus. And I'm accompanied by my co-host, Mr. Money Mustache himself, Eric Hornung.
Unfortunately, Jay, maybe you can't see it through this pop filter, but the mustache is no longer.
It's a little stubbly.
Yeah, it's a little stubbly. It'll be my first full shave since I got rid of the mustache. I did the first 2 months of quarantine with the beard and the mustache. I was doing my best Jay Klaus. And then I said, you know what? I'm just not a beard guy. It's not, it's itchy. It's, I think I've described it previously on the podcast as puby.
And I cringe every time you say the word puby on the podcast.
Yeah. It's, I probably said it too many times on the podcast, I would say. But yeah, once you get rid of the beard and you're looking yourself in the mirror and you say, can I pull this off? If I walk out of this bathroom, will my fiance kill me? And you just go for it. And it's a magical moment, Jay, when there's a shriek and then an acceptance of this is who I am now. I'm a mustache guy.
You sent me the photo and I was like, oh, I'm so glad that you shaved it in this order and took the time to get a photo of this before it's gone. And then it stuck around.
6 weeks. Yeah.
Was it really there for 6 weeks?
It might have been 5 weeks, but yeah, something like that.
Wow. And Colleen was okay with it.
I think she liked it better than the beard.
Wow.
Yeah. So it was a nice mustache. I won't lie. Like I trimmed it up. I gave it a little bit of love. It's just, you know, the mustache life is tough, Jay, because you drink a little bit of milk. You got mustache in your milk. Milk in your mustache, whatever it is.
See, I actually don't experience many of the mustache pains myself because my mustache is the weakest part of my beard.
Mm.
So yeah, I go on and enumerate on the number of mustache problems.
Yeah. Yeah. You ever eaten a hot wing with a mustache? You got hot wing for the next 4 hours because it's not leaving your mustache. anyway, yeah. So the mustache, the whole that whole phase is behind me, Jay. But it lives on in memoriam.
Well, I'm glad that you made the jump into not only trying the beard but trying a mustache. And speaking of jump, today we are talking with Saurabh Sharma. He is a partner at Jump Capital, a thesis-led, sector-focused, and operating-centric venture capital firm specializing in Series A and B and growth stage investments. Jump Capital invests in data-driven technology companies within the fintech, B2B SaaS, IT data infrastructure, and media sectors. They're based in both Chicago and New York. Eric, how did we find Jump Capital?
I got connected with Jump Capital indirectly, I think 2 years ago, maybe it was via Twitter or via an email or something. And so I don't exactly remember how it happened, but I've been in contact via email with a few of the partners there just because I really like the way that they are structured and set up and what they focus on. And they're very explicit about what they do, which I find to be refreshing in the venture capital space. And we wanted to have a conversation with them and, you know, we got to have one today.
Jump Capital has invested in a previous podco, Balto. They've invested in Personal Capital, just to name a couple of companies that you've heard of. Also, Listener in Cincinnati. You talked about them being explicit in what they actually invest in. They also say on their website that they invest $1 to $10 million in their first investment when companies have a $1 to $5 million revenue run rate, and typically less than $10 million of investment so far to date. So yeah, very explicit on their website in terms of industry, what types of companies they're looking for, even at what stage, you know, the investment and the investment terms are.
Yeah, they have a operating partner model, which is much more like private equity than it is a lot of the venture capital firms we talk to. It's the platform model almost. So when you're very specific about the types of companies that you're going to invest in, I think that operating model becomes stronger because you can get the best people to do the specific thing that needs to be done in these four focus areas in that very specific space where it's product market fit has been met and it is growth time.
All right. Well, we'd love to hear your thoughts on this episode with Saurabh as we go through. You can tweet at us at UpsideFM or email us hello@upside.fm. And we'll get into that interview right after this. This episode of Upside is sponsored by Tresta. Tresta is an app for iPhone and Android that lets you do business calling and texting from anywhere with no hardware, just the smartphone you're already using. Tresta is the best business phone app on the market. Whether you're a founder or freelancer just starting your business, or you're already established, growing your network and your business is all about communication. You've got to be available no matter where you are. Tresta offers the call management features that empower you to communicate smarter and more efficiently, like auto attendance, call recording, user groups, and more. And you don't need any special equipment, just the smartphone you're already using. Tresta is easy to configure, so you can set everything up yourself, all online. Tresta's virtual phone system makes it easier and more affordable than ever to set up a fully functioning mobile office. It's just $15 per user per month with no contract. So start your free 30-day trial today at www.tresta.com/upside. That's www.tresta.com/upside. Saurabh, welcome to the show.
Thank you, folks. Great to be here.
Let's take it on a rocket ship. How did you get to Jump Capital?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of an unconventional path. I don't think I was looking necessarily to be a venture capitalist from a career perspective. I think it's a very organic way. My journey has been a little bit all over the place, which I think bodes well to venture, frankly, just kind of the amalgamation of a bunch of things. But, you know, fundamentally, I'm an engineer by training in computer science. Grew up in India, did my engineering there. Got a scholarship to do a part of my undergrad in France, finished that, became a computer science researcher in France in the National Research Labs, got an opportunity to come to my master's and possibly PhD at Cornell. Went there and just kind of got brainwashed out of academia by Wall Street, Lehman Brothers and all the banks that generally go to campuses and hire, you know, quant and computer science guys. So I just finished my master's in Cornell, joined Lehman on a quant algo trading desk. Was there, you know, in the heydays. I mean, this was the perfect time. I was there at Lehman 04 to 08, kind of the peak of Lehman, and saw, you know, phenomenal times. Obviously, ranging from building very large-scale architectures for computational trading in New York, London, and some phenomenal desks in the rates trading, which was, you know, pretty amazing those days. Saw the debacle. I was there, you know, almost to the end, not exactly to the end. I had an opportunity to apply for business schools, which I had been pushing off, and I thought maybe a good time. After 07, there were some signs they might be weaker. And when I got my admits, I kind of took some time off and moved to India back to do some small stint in private equity before business school. But I didn't know it was going to blow up. It kind of blew up pretty much the first week I started my business school in at Chicago Boots. So the next 2 years was just kind of experimenting, you know, starting my own company with a bunch of my friends. And then, you know, those who, I knew two friends, started and kind of joined them in their effort. And then post that, went back to Wall Street a little bit at Barclays Capital with Bob Lehman at the time. Realized it probably wasn't for me. Back in the financial services that changed quite a bit. So joined an early stage fund called Light Bank out of Chicago, started by Eric Lefkowski, Brad Keewell, very well-known entrepreneurs in the region. They had funded that startup that I was involved with earlier. And then, you know, I spent some time with Light Bank. Eric ended up being the Groupon CEO, asked me to come along during some interesting times when we were kind of turning around the story. And so another kind of run at pretty phenomenal setup of interesting projects of turning around the business. I was involved with kind of an internal data science team around mobile relevance strategy. And then we bought a fashion e-commerce in New York, so running operations and marketing for that. For that business, and then intersected with folks at Jump, and it was kind of a good amalgamation. You know, Jump, as we will talk about more, it has some relevance to some trading routes, very computational focus, and so that kind of all put it together. You know, kind of my trading background. I've been venture. I've been doing tech, and so joined Jump for about 4.5 years ago. So again, somewhat unconventional, but took me multiple paths. But I think all that is super helpful, both from being an operator and investor, which I think kind of fits well in venture.
leaving Lehman in 07, 08, and they say you can't time the market, huh?
Yeah, 08, yeah, that's true. That probably was, it's interesting. And, I was probably going to be, Lehman was going to pay for my business school. So that's the only, opportunity cost-wise, it became quite a bit. But yeah, I can't complain. I was in business school in September 08.
What's the difference between doing business, specifically private equity style business in India versus doing it in the United States?
Yeah, I mean, private equity in India is very different. It's by design, it's a high growth market, right? It's, it's been obviously the country as a whole has been growing fast. So there's no real LBOs there. It's not a levered market. Everything is growth equity in itself. Even private equity where you do majority purchases still all equity. That's one piece. Second, I think the ticket sizes are small. I mean, you just don't have many, many multi-billion dollar businesses in India. All the larger ones are, many of them are sort of family-run businesses. So smaller clips. I think the third is, I think it's just a different kind of work culture or governance culture. So you have to be just comfortable navigating that. The promoter aspect and how to deal with people who are used to doing businesses in Indian way is probably a third aspect of it. So all those things, I would say it's very structurally different. And also, they do financially structure those transactions somewhat different as well. U.S. is a sophisticated market, of course, has, obviously matured over many, many years. So they're just any ecosystem player you play with, the debt guys, the lenders, equity guys, just kind of a machine in that sense, both on the entry point, the exit side. So I think it's very different from that. Yeah, I mean, I don't know if your question was, kind of translating that to a venture. I mean, venture is just, one, it's just a totem pole opposite from, private equity. I think the sum relevance is that growing markets, but, here you're solving for technology disruption, the most cutting edge things out there, just changing the status quo. And so I would say good parallels in terms of growth. I would say good parallel also in terms of a lot of technology, because a lot of stuff in private equity is kind of, you look at a lot of outsourced businesses and IT services kind of businesses, which kind of both relevant to venture. But other than that, I mean, venture is going early, taking a very long-term view, and then really build up, right? Versus necessarily focus on, cash flow optimization and so forth, of course. We want to do that, but that's probably a kind of a second thought as business skills.
You were at Groupon in Chicago, which is one of the more storied startup companies in Chicago, and you were working on the head of relevance strategy, personalization for these products. I would love to hear what the nature of some of the problems you're trying to solve were and any of the lessons learned doing that in terms of search and personalization, because I have to think it was kind of a frontier effort that is probably more commonplace in products today.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about Groupon, the story, right, it's one of the first big hyper-local story, right? This is a time when you talk about solo mode, social, local, mobile, and everyone was talking about that, and Groupon was, just really broadening that phase. And when you talk about the hyper-local concept, one, mobile is the centerpiece of it, just because you're carrying your phone, and it's all about how can I present you the most relevant piece or deal to you as you walk by the pizza store or the hair salon or anything. So you're right, that product that I was involved with is by the center of it, of solving that relevance problem and solving that recommendation problem. And it's very different from traditional recommendations of, hey, you buy this product, why don't you buy this product as well? Which is, not easy, but, it's somewhat of a, I would say, vanilla in terms of versus solving something in real time and relevance. So, it was a combination of large data science effort, collecting tons of petabytes of data, and then solving for that in real time, and then optimizing on that, right? And that was a centerpiece of driving revenue for at least the local business for Groupon. Groupon has a goods business and a travel business, but local was the biggest, and it was pretty cool to that. And I was very specifically focused on the mobile piece because the email piece, which you all know, we've been known for sending tons of emails, which is more sort of static, and this is more dynamic. So phenomenal, it was a phenomenal experience, mostly because at that time, to be able to work with such scale of data is exciting in itself. And that with that data, as we all know, solving for data science and machine learning problems, the more data, the more interesting work you can do with it. So with that second piece. So I was kind of more on the product side, working pretty closely with the business teams on one end, right, who were delivering these products, and then other side, our core data science machinery teams were kind of building and optimizing the models, and we are basically solving for optimization, right, and feedback on both sides. Either the data part is not correct, or then if you get the modeling results, then how do you then present the right deals and then source those deals according to the feedback loop on getting the right kind of deals in front of those customers.
We hear so much about how data science has been accelerating in the last few years. What were the limitations you were running into at Groupon when it came to data and data science?
Aggregation is always a challenge, right? You know, luckily, Groupon was early enough in building a very nice infrastructure on the aggregation side. But you can still solve the aggregation challenge. The bigger challenge that comes is data normalization and cleaning. You will hear from anyone who's kind of working in that field, you know, people talk about the analytics at the end. You know, I don't want to diminish analytics, of course, and that's core, but you can't do analytics unless you have data normalization. So we had a huge effort on normalization, data cleaning, harmonization, and then finding the right data, then build the models and model optimization, create that feedback loop. And I would say that I can't say that that challenge has been really solved even today. It's probably better, but then more sorts of data now come into the mix. And then when you start mixing structured and unstructured data with blob data, with object data, all of that poses more challenges. So I think the infrastructure layer which solves that is pretty critical. And I would say those were the challenges we were facing at that time. I mean, the second order challenges were always about, you know, accuracy. And I would say real-time nature of some of the work that I was doing was also pretty hard because it's when you go for real-time, you're kind of somewhat scoping out the amount of data that you have to work with to produce a result because you're putting some signals. And so that's, you know, that's another set of problem, right? It's kind of like solving for real-time streaming data challenges and so forth as well.
So often we see venture capitalists kind of have this association with what they want to invest in versus what they have historically been involved in. So when we look at your background and it's Lehman and finance and then Groupon, I would think, okay, you're going to be really heavily involved in the consumer space, the fintech space. And then you look at your resume and it's cloud infrastructure and enterprise software. How did when you met Jump, you said, I want to go in and focus on these two things?
Cloud infrastructure is actually pretty relevant to my background. I'm a computer science major, undergrad, master's. My earlier research was in parallel computing and compiler optimization. So pretty deeply technical and as hardcore you can get. And all my work at Lehman was all quantitative algorithmic trading. And that is all about building, it's not really financial calculations. It's really building large-scale architecture and solving for modeling and so forth. So I would say up to that point, it's actually super relevant to what I do. And, you know, financial services is one of the biggest buyers of all the deep, and probably the best buyers of anything infrastructure. So that part of that deal was pretty clear. Within Groupon itself, right, again, I was in, you know, a data science modeling mobile relevance team. So again, very relevant to what I invest in. I invest a lot of marketing analytics here, all that stuff. So, and I was running a, you know, large competition marketing stack for the e-com business that we bought at Groupon. So, you know, really evaluating tons of MarTech there and the operation software. Yeah, on the consumer piece, you're right. I mean, both including at Lightbank, which I, you know, I would say at that time at least was very consumer heavy, especially we have American Brad's background, some Groupon story, and then Groupon experience itself. I don't think we preclude consumer as such. I just think we are significantly more enterprise software heavy. I would say if it's a pure consumer deal within Jump, I probably would take a front seat in evaluating that, and we do look at that. I think consumer in general is hard, and e-com is even harder. And I think the era of Amazon and Walmart now actually doing a pretty good job. I just make the other e-com ecosystem just a kind of a harder bet for us to spend time on when there's so much other technology stuff too for us to go after.
What makes Jump a better capital partner for an entrepreneur than other capital partners?
I'm going to kind of steal a phrase from my partner, Satya, who always say there are only so many permutations on venture. You know, I think we keep it simple. Of course, we are a financial partner, and I would say there are some benefits on that side of how we are structured. We have this benefit of having a kind of a small LP base, which allows us to structure our fund in a very flexible way, where we could be very patient capital and then continue to invest along the life cycle of the company from our investment point to all the way to late stages of the business, right? And we're somewhat less restricted and through structurally as the fund is around some of the real constraints of fund around timelines. So that's probably one structural benefit, right, to the extent it comes to play in some times. The other is I think the operating DNA of the team, right? That's probably the number one element here. All of us come from operating backgrounds, and I would say that DNA kind of flows in somewhat automatically. You want to roll up your sleeves. You're going to help the companies to the extent they need, right? We're not enforcing this. And I would say that combined with, to some extent, a Midwest pragmatism in building these businesses, I do think that differentiates, not to take away the growth and the aggressive mentality there. But I think we're always balancing the two acts and not just get lost in the bravado of what's happening in the tech ecosystem. We have some unique institutional resources, I believe. On the operating side, you know, we're an operating partners team, which help companies very specifically on finance, sales, core dev. And somewhat of a unique resource we have is a kind of our own R&D lab as part of Urbana-Champaign's computer science department called Jump Labs. And we structure these projects for portfolio companies with professors and postdocs and kind of pass that benefit to our portfolio companies. And I would say that's that R&D moat and a kind of our deep domain knowledge. And that is somewhat unique in the venture ecosystem. But again, listen, I think to the end, we want to be extremely entrepreneur friendly. We want to provide as much help we can and just kind of stay humble. And then more importantly, just be ready whenever they need us.
You've been a quantitative trader and now a venture capitalist. And I can't think of two financial professions that have more different feedback loop lengths. How do you think about and adapt to the long feedback loop coming from a quantitative background and trading background?
It's a question of how do you allocate the timeframes in your head, right? You're solving for different things, right? In venture, you're solving for building, right? And so you have to be in this business with that build mentality, which then translates to return. Otherwise, you're going to be frustrated pretty early on. Venture by design is minority investment, so you can't really force outcomes. And as we're now learning, we can't control so much macro. You can do everything right, and then coronavirus hits, and then all your plans change. So that's, I think there's a build mentality, and I think maybe it's a combination of coming from computer science background, actually building a lot of systems myself early on. I think that was there as a natural. You know, trading is about data aggregation and then producing results pretty quickly and getting an output there, right? I think you could argue maybe I was probably not the lifelong trader, otherwise I would have never left. And maybe there are people who just live for that thrill. And I don't think so they would survive in venture for the same reason you're asking that question. And I probably wasn't that person, and hence I moved on. I think also I was not the guy in the sales and trading pit, living for the thrill and kind of shouting. I was the guy building systems to the back end, let the machine do its job. So there is an aspect of building there. And, to be honest, we were thinking a lot of long-term stuff there. So I would say there was, to the extent possible, that you said, there could be different. Yes, they're different, but there's some semblance of closeness of the exact scope I was on. And I think I'm enjoying this game quite a bit as well.
I want to dive a little bit into cloud infrastructure. It's something we haven't covered much, if at all, on this podcast. So maybe we can take this a little high level first. What is a cloud infrastructure company? What do they provide? Who are they selling to? How do they make money? Just can you kind of maybe lay this out, explain it like we're 18?
Yeah, super layman, right? I mean, I think at the lowest level, we're all used to using our personal computers, right? And then the enterprises, maybe an enterprise CPUs. When you're using CPUs to the extent, if you go to the level below that, people are using data centers at the companies where companies have their own physical facilities, which is providing all that compute power and then storage power to run your enterprise system. So that's kind of going from personal device to an enterprise device to then an enterprise level physical infrastructure setup. As I talk to that, there are obvious scaling challenges that become obvious, right? It's physical data centers, physical facilities, and in the world when you are one, ramping up pretty quickly, but in times like this, you're ramping down pretty quickly. You are now dealing with significant CapEx issues, and then more importantly, constraints on how to even do that. Then I can just throw a myriad of terms, complex terms around, virtual machines and so forth, which starts coming into play, which all that really means is that you just want insane amount of flexibility to be able to move fast and agile to stay competitive in the ecosystem. Cloud as a concept is relatively old. The underlying of it is the concept of distributed systems, which you can deploy on-prem, which I think we are kind of coming back to that now. But when it started, is the idea of distributed layer of how can you pool the resources in one aggregation way and then give that benefit to multiple people? And then can you scale that? And that's what, you know, folks like AWS and then now Azure and Cloud has done, where it gives the companies the ability to rent the compute facility instead of their own physical data centers. And when they say rent, by design, there's a variable aspect to it, and there's an elasticity aspect to it where you can scale up and down as you need without ever having to worry about buying anything and then without having to worry about getting them set up. So that's, you know, in fundamentally level, it's cloud. It's, you know, stuff that sits somewhere else. You're pooling with someone else, you don't know, and then it scales elastically.
So when you're looking at investments, are you primarily looking at, okay, these companies are competing head-to-head with AWS or Azure, or are you looking at applications above that? What is interesting in cloud right now?
Our remit is pretty broad. So I spend, you know, time on enterprise IT and data infrastructure, which includes everything that you just said, including developer tools, you know, coding tools and analytic tools, and then also enterprise, general enterprise software, right? So obviously we spend equal time on application software versus IT infrastructure software. On the IT infrastructure software side, it, as I said, ranges from companies are not necessarily competing with, you know, Amazon Web Services or Google Cloud, because those guys are fundamentally platform players where they provide you that compute layer as we talked about, right? So, and their goal and business is to basically make that layer almost exist everywhere. And so they're solving the scalability challenges and then all the tooling to make that layer easily accessible and scalable. But as you access that layer, there is so much other aspects of running your applications on the layer. And I think we spend a lot of time at that level, which deals with things around application deployment, things with monitoring the performance of your applications, things like security of running that stuff. And I'm obviously talking in context of cloud, but obviously we talk about the same stuff at on-premise. A lot of the world is talking about hybrid because not every company is going to be able to move to cloud 100% of their workloads by design. So if you think about an IT manager, he has now to manage two different environments, one on cloud, one on-prem, and then probably have to move workloads between one and another all the time. And so there's a ton of complexity in all that. So we play across all those layers fundamentally, but I don't think so we'll necessarily invest in anything which is directly competing in providing cloud services. There's one company in the portfolio company called Rescale, which is providing that cloud, fundamental cloud layer, very focused on high performance computing. So think about the, you know, supercomputers and Cray machines and GPUs. And that's somewhat of a niche, in some sense, a segment of that cloud compute for very critical or high-end tasks like industrial design simulation, you know, genetic computing and so forth. So I would say that's probably one company in that layer, which I think may be somewhat competitive, but I think it's also a very good partner to all of them, because again, those guys are not solving for business challenges of running those workloads and solving for all the middleware layer. And that's what Rescale does. And at the back end, they actually partner with all the cloud providers.
By being this thesis-led, sector-focused investing firm, do you find that you face less competition than some of your venture peers because you are more specific and thesis driven, or because you are more specific that those deals themselves are more competitive?
Good question. I would say it is a differentiating element to the extent, you know, we are doing thought-provoking work around this and then actually being going super deep in that. I think it's hard to be only thesis led or only thesis focused. I think there are kind of we play on sort of both sides, but I think a lot of our internal thinking, it's hard to be just, you know, not having any focus and just be running around looking for technology companies. And more importantly, all of us are strengths in our passion areas, and that drives the work that we do in our thesis, and our team does some great work. A lot of my team members spend a lot of time thinking about certain areas. And what that translates into, I can't really speak to, you know, how does it kind of put in a position of winning the deals, because I'm sure other folks are spending time. But I do think it gives us a seat on the table with a lot of credibility, because the conversations that we have with the entrepreneurs are well thought out, well researched. And then more importantly, then automatically building some value proposition for those guys as a result of our work that have been done, right? I think also the thesis-led aspect is important, because when you talk to these entrepreneurs and then you have these conversations, there is an aspect of kind of a network effect, because you're basically able to touch a wide segment in a sector. And so to your point, there's some an inbound aspect to that. And just people kind of, you know, it's a, the content is perpetual these days, right? So there's a long lasting impact, and you might be thinking about something that might become significantly more relevant 2 years from now. And that obviously plays to our benefit. I think it's a differentiating piece. I think it necessarily puts us a little bit of a, in a better spot to have those conversations. Venture is competitive. I would say there's no sector or subsector which is not competitive, but you could have stronger conviction in certain areas than others, and that would sort of set you apart.
Well, to follow up on that, I'm interested to hear, when you're meeting with these entrepreneurs and they're considering taking investment from Jump Capital, how often is it that your operating partnership or your R&D lab, how often is that the swing versus kind of a pleasant surprise after they've been working with you guys for a little bit?
I would say it's a pretty, again, depending on the companies, right? I think it's a factor for sure. You know, our core entry points are Series A and B, right? And if you think about a Series A company, those operating resources are actually very helpful. I think it's less for Series C company. They've kind of scaled up. They probably hire the senior management team, and they don't necessarily need to feel the need to have some advice around sales and marketing and so forth. At Series A, you know, this is a young entrepreneur who's kind of got product market fit, and he's kind of looking for, you know, advice. And you can get advice in general from other entrepreneurs, but then when you're your own investor with the skin in the game, with the money on the table, is going to provide you very, very relevant. And then obviously then follow up with action, you know, because advice on its own, it's tough. I mean, there's so much content out there, I can just read everything, but it doesn't work out. So the tactical rolling the sleeves in and then almost repeating the playbooks, because we've seen so much of this, is I think it's pretty helpful. And I do think a lot of folks listen to that. We offer, you know, introductions to our portfolio companies who have gone through this, and that part of the process automatically then I think steps up in making a decision. Same goes for, I mean, some stuff on the R&D side, right? Infrastructure companies, I think that is unique. Because if you think about, even you have the most cutting edge team solving for something, you're going to solve for very short term needs. You have a 6 month to 9 month plan. And more importantly, that's all the team you have. You can't be thinking about an R&D project of what this could be catapulting to next level in 12 months. And you can't afford that. And more importantly, you can't afford the talent of the best professor in the best area, you know, at a top university. So to be able to give them that scope and say, why don't you let us kind of work on a project, it turns out to something amazing at the end of it, and then you get it, you know, for at no cost. And if it works out, then you can productize it, which is great. That, so to think about that R&D angle is just huge for any infrastructure company.
Do you find that the majority of your portfolio companies, the entrepreneurs that you're looking at, even in the deal flow stages, are they usually steeped in industry knowledge and experience, and that leads them to come up with these innovations? Or are they coming from outside of the space and kind of looking at it with a new lens?
Are you talking about the CEOs that we look at?
Yeah, or the founders generally.
I think the domain knowledge is the most powerful thing you look for in entrepreneur. And not to diminish the hustle and then obviously the entrepreneurial nature. And I think they go kind of hand in hand. But like I would say, you know, in technical companies, I think that's almost a must. You just can't build a technical company or an infrastructure company or, you know, somewhat core computer science or engineering company without having a domain knowledge. So for us, that's almost a must. It's a given. I think it would be very uncomfortable, you know, pooling those resources and trying to build a company around it. In application companies, again, I think to the extent domain knowledge, I think that just goes a long way in setting you apart, because you save so much time that you're going to do on aggregating the knowledge from your own work. And listen, you can't replace that learning in any way of putting it on, but you can definitely accelerate it if you've already started from that. We have a company in Chicago, a company called LogicGate, where the founders come from the GRC ecosystem. And I would say, you know, it's pretty visible how they are able to move significantly faster, almost own that space, versus building a general purpose platform, just because they spent so many years kind of giving their advice. And day one, they knew exactly what to build. The roadmap was so clear versus waiting for the customer feedback, because they've already gotten that feedback many, many times over the last couple of years of experience.
How important is technical diligence then when you're looking at a company? Like, are you guys going through code bases and saying, this is a very technically sound product, or are you kind of relying more on the entrepreneur and their roadmap?
I would say it's pretty important. You know, I don't think so. We go to the extent of, you know, reviewing every code and the code bases. I think it's to some extent it's a combination of a little bit of domain knowledge, including me. We do have access to some phenomenal resources through Jump and Jump ecosystem of the highest end caliber that you can imagine in computer science. And so we generally loop those domain specific people in. And, you know, the conversations automatically, it's, you know, sort of kind of showcase the depth of the product. You know, this is not, again, this is maybe, you know, comparing to private equity where you're kind of buying maybe not the most cutting edge company built on old school tech where you're worried about, you know, Snoop code and vulnerabilities and so forth, right? These are newer stacks by design because these are newer companies. So, you know, when you talk to the entrepreneur, you talk to the background, I think you get comfortable with the quality of the code they're producing. It's all about how they're thinking about the product, what architectural problems are they solving, the way they're thinking about the architecture design is probably more tenets that we focus on. And I think those conversations, we go pretty deep in and we find the right guys to have those conversations in. And I guess, you know, we have to have conviction on the bets we make in the space.
To wrap up this interview, how would you summarize Jump's thesis?
It's probably kind of positioning our tagline, right? We're thesis-led, operational-centric focus firm. And our core thesis is that we have been very focused on finding companies which are solving for the future. They have some core combination of domain knowledge or IP at the back door of which are they building these things. And they have the hustle to, you know, brave the times that they have and think for the long term. We also look for practicality in the entrepreneurs they look for. I think that's somewhat different than many other firms. And that's important to us because I think this is a long game and you can't win the long game unless you have the ability to kind of stomach the ups and downs that come with it. And the practicality is a pretty strong component to that.
Awesome. Saurabh, thanks so much for joining us. If people want to learn more about Jump Capital or get in touch with your team after the show, where should they go?
You should come to jumpcap.com. I'm happy to share my email addresses, which is my first name at jumpcap.com. I'm on LinkedIn, and so is all my team members. So feel free to reach us out on Twitter, LinkedIn, send messages. We hope that we're listening to all the entrepreneurs. And I would say, listen, we are one of the few firms who, one, play at the stage that we play at, also spend a lot of time in enterprise software, also one of the few firms who will do deeply technical investing in mid-investment content. I don't think there are many firms who spend time on that. And I don't want to be traveling too far. So I would love to find companies closer to us. So anyone who's building companies around the region, please reach out.
Hey, listener, have you ever wanted to get a message in front of the Upside audience but weren't sure how to sponsor the show or weren't able to do a long-term sponsorship? Well, now you can just go to upside.fm/classifieds and let our audience know anything that's going on in your world, whether it's an event, an application, a special coupon or deal, or just letting them know who you are, what your company does. All you have to do is go to upside.fm/classifieds and you can place an ad on this show. That's upside.fm/classifieds.
All right, Jay, we just spoke with Jump Capital. And it was my, like, I've read about cloud computing and infrastructure, and maybe it's just because it's one of those spaces you need a little bit more experience in. I was really happy we did this interview. I don't know a lot about that space from a first principles level.
Saurabh is obviously deeply knowledgeable about all of these industries they talked about. Dating back to his experience with Groupon in 2013, you know, we kind of kicked this off talking about if you are leading personalization at Groupon, as Groupon is becoming a unicorn within Chicago, that's going to give you a lot of really unique perspective when it comes to machine learning and infrastructure, because that thing scaled very, very quickly and was really a forerunner in this deals category. So, you know, something that sticks out to me, and I said this to Saurabh at the end of the interview, a lot of venture capital firms will talk about how they really want to be a partner with their portfolio companies and play more of a role than just money. And that kind of comes off as lip service to me a lot of the time. But with the partners that are involved at Jump Capital, like Saurabh, who have this operating experience at companies like Groupon, I just get a sense that there's some real weight to their words and that they back that claim up.
I think you can also see that when you just scroll through the individuals on their Meet the Team page, where it's a lot of operating partners, a lot of people who are probably working in their portfolio companies and with their portfolio companies versus investment partners where they're making an investment and stepping back.
And looking at Saurabh's LinkedIn, he also has more companies listed where he is a venture investor and board observer than any investor you've had on the show. And that's, you know, that could just be to say that he's really great at LinkedIn and really updates, you know, the companies he's involved in. But to me, that really underscores how many companies value his insight in the spaces that Jump invests in.
I think this is going to be one of those interviews that when we have IT infrastructure companies on the podcast or enterprise software companies on the podcast, we're going to be referencing back to a lot. It's one of those podcast episodes that lays a foundation for us to be better hosts going forward.
I feel smarter.
Well, that's not that hard, Jay.
Speak for yourself. You don't know my brain.
I think I have a pretty good indication of what's going on up there.
All right, guys, we'll keep this one short and sweet. If you had thoughts on this interview with Saurabh, please tweet at us at UpsideFM or email us hello@upside.fm. We'd love to talk to more thesis-driven venture capitalists. So if you have anyone in your network that you would like to hear from, please let us know hello@upside.fm, and we'll talk to you next week.
That's all for this week. Thanks for listening. We'd love to hear your thoughts on today's guest. So shoot us an email at hello@upside.fm or find us on Twitter @UpsideFM. We'll be back here next week at the same time talking to another founder in our quest to find upside outside of Silicon Valley. If you or someone you know would make a good guest for our show, please email us or find us on Twitter and let us know. And if you love our show, please leave us a review on iTunes. That goes a long way in helping us spread the word and continue to help bring high-quality guests to the show. Eric and I decided there are a couple things we wanted to share with you at the end of the podcast, and so here we go. Eric Hornung and Jay Klaus are the founding parties of the Upside Podcast. At the time of this recording, we do not own equity or other financial interest in the companies which appear on this show. All opinions expressed by podcast participants are solely their own opinion and do not reflect the opinions of Duff & Phelps LLC and its affiliates, Unreal Collective LLC and its affiliates, or any entity which employ us. This podcast is for informational purposes only and should not be relied upon as a basis for investment decisions. We have not considered your specific financial situation nor provided any investment advice on this show. Thanks for listening, and we'll talk to you next week. Never mind. Bro, that can't be mad. I'm lighting it on fire. Used to run victory laps. And still, I'm not even tired. It's all about the timing, about the timing. Yeah, that's what they say. Well, I'ma keep on riding.